Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the first panel of the day. We've got an excellent team of panelists lined up for you. We have Timo Tata, whom you've already met. Timo is Deputy Secretary General for Energy and Mineral Resources at Estonia's Ministry of Economic Affairs. We've got Martin Schmidt, Head of Business Development at Northern Lights. And don't know if he's with us yet. Do we have Christian Holzleitner anywhere? Well, maybe we'll just have to start without him, or well, Christian Holzleitner, Director General for Climate Action at the European Commission, was due to be here with us this morning. Maybe I should just start by asking you, Timo and Martin, to give a short presentation of yourselves and the organization or enterprise that you represent. Please, Tim, would you start? It's going to be very brief for you, I know.
Yes, I'm coming from Ministry of Economic Affairs and Communications from Estonia, which is responsible for energy policy in Estonia. My background actually is thermal engineering, so which I think is a great help for me doing my job. I've been in that position for 2 years now, and before that I also worked for 5 years in the ministry. Before that I worked in different energy companies with the project of power or development, power generation developments. So in previous years in my before life, I have developed a couple of power plants myself. So this has given me the knowledge about the energy policy. I think as opening remarks, those are all. This is it. Thank you.
Thanks. Moving on to you, Martin.
Good morning. Good morning, everybody. My name is Martijn Schmidt. I'm a Dutch national, actually, sitting home in the Netherlands. I work I represent the Northern Lights today, which is a joint venture company between Shell, Total, and Equinor. We are providing CCS services, and that's a dedicated purpose of the company. I'm in that organization coming from Equinor, which is the Norwegian state-owned energy company. My background is actually geology originally, and then I've done business school, always been working on a commercial side, but always within the private-public space. So within the Dutch setting, the natural gas developments and the Groningen field, within Equinor also the kind of business development for upstream assets. And country management with local stakeholder management. So recently joined the Northern Lights, heading up the business development team. We have had a number of engagement also in the Baltics, and still have. And happy to join the dialogue today.
Excellent.
Thanks for having me.
Nice having you. And yes, let's head straight into the issue of Baltic energy security. Because overall, the Baltic region is likely to be in energy deficit for the coming decade. And as we saw this winter, prices can go up very quickly, especially when the wind doesn't blow and when every country in the region is relying on baseload supply. So Timo, with the move towards having more wind-generated energy in the mix, how is the Baltic energy security going to improve over the coming decade?
Yes, the largest energy security project for Baltics is the Baltic power system synchronization with continental Europe. This is a project which have been prepared for, I don't know, 10 years or even more. And now, gladly, we are finally in the phase where I believe we have passed the point of no return. The project has secured the financing, which is more than a billion euros altogether in three Baltic states and Poland, and we intend to synchronize our power systems with continental Europe through Poland by 2025. And this will take care of the largest sort of strategical risk of the Baltic states right now, that our Baltic power system, due to historical reasons, are still heavily linked with the Russian, Belarusian electricity system. So this is one project related to energy security we are dealing with. But of course, this is on a power system operational level. What you were mentioning is the tendency which we are having, I think, everywhere in Europe, that a dispatchable generation is being decommissioned due to the high CO2 prices, and the new generation coming online tends to be more non-dispatchable, intermediate generation, is wind or solar. The same tendencies are happening also in Estonia, and of course this puts also a challenge for the transmission system operators, whose role is to take care of the security supply. And thanks to the good connections which Estonia has with other Nordic countries and Baltic countries, our transmission system operator right now is confident that even though if those trends are going forward, that we see more and more intermediate generation coming online, there is no imminent risk for security supply in a foreseeable future. Although, having said that, we at the ministry are already preparing sort of a safety net regulation, that if one point we see that there is a risk for security supply, then transmission system operator together with the energy regulator can step in and then add or include projects into the strategical reserve. So the same solution of strategical reserve is already being used in some of the Nordic countries, and I believe if the need is there, then Estonia is willing to do the same. So to have the minimum necessary amount of dispatchable generation available also in Estonia at every given point of time. But right now we are seeing that we are not yet there yet. We let the market signals to do their work, as it usually is, that if there is more intermediate generation in the market prices tend to be more volatile, and of course this volatility is creating additional business opportunities for storage as such, for hydrogen, and we truly believe that that the state should sort of interfere not too early, of course also not too late, but first of all we should let the market participants to figure out new innovative ways how to provide the necessary services which the market needs. And if that sort of fails, then of course the TSOs together with the energy regulators will step in. Thank you.
Excellent. Let us just, we'll return to the hydrogen question in a second. Can we just ask Christian to please introduce himself?
Yes, hi. Hi, good morning. I'm so sorry. I mismanaged the time difference. I'm very happy to be with you. I'm Christian Holzleitner. I'm working here in Brussels with the Director General for Climate Action at the European Commission. And like one of the main, or our main objective is to get a climate neutral Europe in 2050. So we want in 2050 on balance to not emit any more greenhouse gases. And how do we get there? We get there by phasing out the fossil fuels and increasing the removal, so the capacity that of our soils, forests to store CO2, but also from technological solutions like CCS as the project platform from Northern Lights shows. And our main tool here is the emission trading system. So with which we want to give the right price signals to switch to more renewable energy. But there's also the other side to the emission trading system. It's all the revenues. We are currently at a carbon price of above 50 euros, which we wouldn't have thought to have like 2-3 years ago. And of course, this gives us a lot of possibilities to smartly use that money to finance the energy transition that we are seeing.
And yes, also to help let me just stop you there, because we were talking about Baltic energy security. So I actually wanted to direct you in the direction of how are these funds and how is this money going to help with the Baltic energy security for the coming decade, please?
Yeah. So these funds can, on the one hand, of course, increase the uptake of renewables, so to increase the capacity of the renewables, but they are also there to finance the extension of the energy networks, and the funds from the emission trading system are, in this respect, of course, not the only funds that we have available here in Europe. There's of course the whole Connecting Europe facility, which is particularly there for the energy infrastructure, for the interconnectors. And then, of course, what is now the really hot topic is the Recovery and Resilience Facility. So all the money with which we want to rebuild Europe after the corona crisis. And 1/3 of that money should go to climate action. And of course, that also includes the measures of energy security. And the member states are now submitting their plans to us in Brussels, and we are looking at them. And of course, we are hoping that a lot of them, of this money, can also help to fund the energy transition.
Excellent. Moving on to you, Martin. You are in carbon storage, and I'm assuming that hydrogen is one of the things you're looking at too, in terms of green hydrogen, possibly. So hydrogen produced by renewable sources. I was wondering if you had a view on whether that will have a role to play in Baltic or indeed Nordic energy security towards 2030.
Yeah, maybe it's good to share a bit the Norwegian Scandinavian perspective to the CCS and the public-private collaboration, and then touch upon the hydrogen dimension. I think there's been a recognition from Norway to building on the oil and gas industry and knowledge. That it's time for action and to start doing something about reaching the climate targets and the Paris under the Paris Agreement. There's a potential for an economic model around CO2 removal, and the Norwegian government has supported our project, plus kind of waste incineration and cement industry. I think for politicians, it's really one of the key questions is what kind of technologies will there be needed and infrastructure by 2050 when we phase out the fossil fuels and go into a European Green Deal. So Northern Lights is very focused and keen to support CO2 removal and infrastructure that has a long-lasting need. So the waste to power, biomass to power, and potentially the hydrogen infrastructure that facilitates a route to green hydrogen are the type of projects and CO2 emissions that we seek to capture and then store. As of now, we are now kind of in dialogues with companies and industrial clusters, cement industry as well, where we to store that CO2 and help them build infrastructure that is also adding value towards 2050 and beyond.
Excellent. And at the heart of all of this is, of course, the challenges in designing the politics and the solution needed for all of this energy transition that we want. So basically, how do we keep the lights on while the system powering those lights is completely changed? And let me just quickly go back to you, Timo, because as you mentioned, Estonia is quite ambitious and has set itself the ambitious goal of having to double its renewable electricity production over this coming decade. And also, at the same time, you want to keep energy consumption steady. You even want to do this while the economy grows and while you're phasing out the oil shale. So what you've quickly touched upon it. What is it that's needed right now? What are the politics and the solutions in terms of investments and technology that will make this happen?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. As you described it, it's a heck of a challenge, and I think we are past time of sort of easy solutions and low hanging fruits. So and as we in Estonia are quite small country, we are confident that moving our economy towards a green energy system, the subsidies should be sort of the last source which we are using. So right now we are focusing our policies very much tackling different obstacles which are keeping sort of the market-based energy transition away. One is, as I mentioned also in my opening remarks, was the big challenge we're facing in Estonia, or the conflict between the air surveillance systems and building wind farms. So I'm confident that we have successfully tackled that challenge, and now we are working with other challenges. One of them, for instance, is how to upgrade our energy systems in a way that it can take in more renewable power, and for that I'm happy to say that we are also planning to use the recovery and resilience funds to upgrade our transmission system in a quicker manner, in a speedier manner, do the necessary works to tackle the bottlenecks in the systems that it can take more renewable energy in. One of the bigger conflicts or challenges which we are facing right now, and which I believe is not very much talked about, is the sort of the challenge how to sort of find a good compromise between different a bit conflicting targets of a country. So large territories in Estonia are under nature protection. So because we have very good nature, we have very high biodiversity, and obviously the future energy systems are using more territories, larger territories. And we have to find compromises how to meet all different targets. On one hand, climate target, and on the other hand, biodiversity targets. So how to find those compromises where all the targets can met at the same time? And when you're asking that, whether Estonian power system from the perspective of security supply can withstand larger amounts of renewable share, then I can say yes. And this is due to the reason that Estonia is already now one of the best connected or interconnected countries. So we have strong interconnections towards Finland, due to historical reasons also towards Russia, and just recently this year we opened or commissioned third interconnection also towards other Baltic states, towards Latvia. So thanks to the very well built interconnections, where by the way we have also have the luxury of using connecting Europe facility funds, our power system is flexible enough to withstand situations where we are producing ourselves very little, and also to withstand situations where our system is heavily exporting. So I believe that the key word here is the interconnectivity, that if we are moving towards this copper plate sort of the energy market in Europe, with all those new investments into interconnections, we are creating also at the same time the resilience which is needed to seek a higher share of renewables.
Well, let me pick up on that one, because with regards to cooperation in the region, is the current level of regional coordination sufficient? Don't know, Martin or Christian, if any of you have a view on that. Christian, maybe you first.
No, but I think what Timo said is really designing the energy system of the future, and it will be a very different one than the one we have now, because we have to invest more into fixed costs, into the networks. But then we have very low or even zero running costs because of all the renewables, and it's about finding these interconnectors. It's about finding new storage solutions, hydrogen batteries, and so on. And I think this is what we want to foster here in Brussels, is also this regional cooperation, I think, which Timo very well explained. And I think also the more renewables we will have in the system, the more you will see the business opportunities that you have there in trading the electricity and in storing it, be it on short term, intraday, day, or even then over longer seasonal storage, where we go more into hydrogen, for example, or into hydropower.
Excellent, Martin. So let's return to carbon storage, or actually go into it properly for the first time, because as a policy, it has it figures high on the agenda with the European Commission, and not all countries, however, are embracing this new technology. I know Estonia is a bit hesitant, and also the IEA has just downplayed the role of carbon storage for the future somewhat. So what do you see, and how important is carbon storage going to be for the Nordic and Baltic 2030 goals? And also, how does the whole regional cooperation come into play?
Yeah, like I said in the previously, I think that there's a whole debate across Europe about, you know, what kind of technologies are prioritized towards 2050. And towards 2050, we talk about net zero. Towards 2030, we talk very much about percentage of reductions, which is not really the same thing. We from Northern Lights for CCS, we are very focused on emitters that have no current solutions or will be emitting in 2050 as well. So waste incineration, for instance, biomass, cement industry, I don't think they have solutions in 2050. And it's that type of emitters that where we provide solutions, and we provide economic activity within the European Union for those type of industries, because they are struggling and they're confronted with climate targets without having technical solutions. Fair to say, and that this is very much also part of our project, is that CCS is as a history, and it's not it's forbidden in many countries onshore within the European Union. So it's as such not embraced. I think one of the reasons why Norway is leading this endeavor is that Norway has stored CO2 for more than 25 years. It has the technology, it has a regulatory framework, and it's offshore. So Norway is willing to provide access to emitters in Europe to store CO2 in Norway and build economic activities around that. So yeah, that's a bit where we are.
Yes, and we've touched on politics, and it's always great at pointing us in a direction, but in the end, it is all about the money. So, Martin, what, as you said, Northern Light is it's a commercial enterprise. And when you're looking and when you're talking to your future customers, what are the options for them in terms of financing models?
So for us, from our project, and we talk with industrials from in the Baltics, France, Ireland, across Europe, it's fair to say that the ETS price is a key driver. We have the overarching Paris Agreement, European Green Deal, and then the ETS price is really the tool and the means at the moment. We're looking forward a bit to the COP26, of course. A lot of countries, and some... in the Nordics particularly, have added taxations on top of the ETS prices. And it's fair to say, from where I sit in my position, and then the countries that added taxations on top of ETS, there's even more traction and more activities within the industrials to find solutions. But compared to other countries that only are referring to the ETS system at the moment. But the ETS is definitely increasing. It has increased a lot. Nobody would have thought it would go that quick. And that helps, that creates action, a lot of action and discussion and dialogues. And it's a positive thing. From my perspective, of course, from an industrial perspective, there is advocacy for a border adjustment, and there is definitely a drive to compensate or have premium prices for green products. Because there's currently some industrials in Europe that compete on an international market, and they struggle. So that it is a dialogue that is currently ongoing.
Excellent. Christian, what are the opportunities available in an EU context for projects in need of funding? And I know you told me about a recent oversubscription, so is there enough money?
Yes. As I said, we have we use the revenues of the emission trading system to fund exactly such projects, the ones that we need for 2050, for a climate neutral economy. With the Innovation Fund, we are now at the current carbon prices. We are expecting to have around 20 billion for the next 10 years, and we really want to kick off big projects like the first hydrogen-based steel mill in Europe. We are also looking a lot into CCS as another solution. We have a lot of projects there around the North Sea that are looking at capturing CO2 and then storing it, be it in Norway, be it in the Netherlands. What I find particularly interesting is, of course, combining CCS with bioenergy, because then we would go into what we call negative emissions. So we would effectively be taking CO2 out of the air, out of the atmosphere. This is what we need in the end. We also have very interesting projects like in batteries, in storage, a lot on circular economy. So companies are really looking into how to reuse waste. We also see a lot of developments on renewables, in particular on offshore. Offshore wind, floating wind. I mean, we have a large potential, be it in the Baltic Sea, the North Sea, but also the Mediterranean has a very high potential for wind energy. We have projects with the next generation of solar cells. And so our first call, we put out 1 billion. We got more than 300 projects asking for 20 billion of subsidies. And this during the COVID crisis. So I think this is something that shows how really this changed compared to 2-3 years ago. People are really into it. I think really at the CEO level, and they all, I think, are also mobilized by Fridays for Futures and so on, by all the societal discussions on that. And I think it's a really big topic, and I think it's really once in a lifetime, but maybe once in a century chance for Europe to become a leader in all these technologies and to really show how you can run an economy without fossil fuels. So I mean, what we are discussing here is, I mean, it's not something minor. We are discussing our energy system for the next one or two generations.
Yes, indeed. Yes, let me I'll return to offshore possibilities in a second. Let me just mention that if anyone in the audience has a question, please post it in the chat and we'll pick it up later on. So, yes, the Baltic Sea and offshore, because if there is one thing that binds the whole Nordic and Baltic region together, it is the Baltic Sea. And it seems at the moment to be quite underexploited, really. Official estimates have the potential for offshore wind in the Baltic Sea as high as 93 gigawatts, And yet, by my estimate, only 6.4 gigawatt worth of projects are currently planned to be properly online in 2030. There may be more in the pipeline, but nothing that has reached a stage where you think this is definitely going to happen. So, Timo, what is keeping Estonia from using its offshore potential?
Yeah, indeed, roughly 9% of Baltic Sea territory is belonging to Estonia. So definitely, if you are calculating that 93 gigawatts altogether is the overall potential, then, well, 8 or 7 of that potential should mathematically be in Estonia. And I'm glad to say that those are the sort of the combined projects outputs also in Estonia. So we estimate that the Estonian potential is somewhat 7 or 8 gigawatts. And you are right that right now all those projects are on the paper yet. So the developments are ongoing. As I also, as I was also mentioning before, the maritime special planning is on a public consultation in Estonia. So I believe, like every country, when it comes to offshore, the countries are still in a sort of preparatory phase. So they are figuring out what is the right regulatory framework, what are the obstacles which we have to sort of tackle. One is definitely simply the cost obstacle, that the offshore wind is so much more expensive compared to onshore. And I believe all those excuses are valid also in Estonia. So many countries have the strategies that for the next 10 years they intend to meet their renewable energy targets on onshore projects or solar projects, simply because they are more cheaper, simply because many of those projects are already sort of achievable without any state subsidies. And this is actually the case with Estonia as well. So we are confident that we will see our first offshore projects at the end of this decade or early next decade, but we are not relying on offshore yet to meet our 2030 targets. And I can say my firm belief is that in that sense, the time is ticking in our favor. So the technologies are becoming more mature, and countries have had more time to enhance cooperation between each other's transmission system operators, you know, have matured their plans of offshore grid, because that's the most important element, that if the energy is more produced in the future offshore, then the grids have to follow where the generation is. And obviously those very expensive investments need proper time to prepare. And right now, I think most of the countries are in this preparatory phase, where sort of the foundations are laid on which the future offshore boom can be based on. And I'm confident that the boom will be there, but I'm also confident that the time invested right now is definitely time well spent in order for this boom to be really a market-based boom where there is a competition, and boom where the energy harvested at seas are directed to the regions where it is needed most. So this is again why I emphasize the importance of cross-border cooperation when it comes to offshore grid. So it's maybe rather simple to build a large offshore wind farm somewhere near to the coast and then build a very direct line to the onshore grid, but then guess what, you are just creating bottlenecks onshore, and then only later realize that it would have been, you know, much wiser to invest maybe a bit more at first and then direct the energy already at sea to the region where the deficit at this or at given moment is the largest. So this is our thinking right now. next 10 years onshore, next 10 years preparatory works for offshore to be in order to become it the reality after 2030.
Excellent. I see you nodding a lot, Christian.
Yes.
Is this something you want to expand on?
Yes, no, definitely, because I think it's very true that also with offshore wind, we are still on this cost curve going down. And this is exactly what we want to do with our European funds, is we want to speed up this development, and we want to reward the first movers there that take more risk in doing it. So I talked about the Innovation Fund. We also have the Modernization Fund from the revenues of the EU emission trading system, which is for the member states with lower income, so that have bigger challenges in financing the energy transition. And we are also starting off that fund now. We will disperse our first money there in summer. There are also projects by Estonia on energy efficiency, transport, but also that would be a good source for the offshore wind, and also for the whole energy and energy infrastructure. But I would fully agree that this goes step by step, and there are also what we see in the Innovation Fund, there are projects that really think about how can we combine the production of the renewable energy with offshore energy, immediately with energy storage solutions, with the production of hydrogen, but also maybe with the other use of the wind farms. So there's more also talking about aquaculture. Could that be used for farms for mussels or algae? And so there are a lot of good ideas around. And I think we'll see so much more within 5 to 10 years. On this, I fully agree.
Excellent. And Martin, can I ask you, is there anything with regards to carbon storage going on in the Baltic Sea?
We're talking with industrials, cement refinery type of companies, and it's far from Norway, storage, but it's not impossible necessarily. So that is one thing. So yes, we can provide a solution for emissions there and to store it for those type of industries. When it comes to geology, I'm not sure you refer to that, geology or actual storing CO2 within the Baltics itself. I think there has been some projects in Poland, but I'm not aware that within the Baltics itself there has been any oil, gas, past production, or any kind of geology that could be made suitable for CO2 storage. I'm not aware of that.
Okay.
Maybe Timo knows, I don't know.
Maybe. Yeah, actually, I guess in Latvia there is a suitable geological formation for CO2 storage as well, because one of the largest natural gas underground storage facilities is in Latvia. So, it's yet to be seen whether Latvia is planning to use its suitable geological formations to store CO2 as well. So. I can't comment that.
Well, CO2 is a huge issue under all circumstances, and as we've briefly touched upon, the price of it has been rising sharply over the past few months. And that's good, and maybe it's bad. I'm wondering if there's any downside to this whole rising cost of emissions. And Christian, your funds rely on the ETS for funding, so.
Yes.
You should be happy, but I'm wondering about the projects that you are looking to sponsor, and if there is a negative impact at all by the higher price of emissions, or if it's all just wonderful.
Of course, we should use smartly the revenues that we have from the emission trading, and I think what one has to consider with this energy transition, or with the whole transition to a climate neutral economy, the energy system will change because we will have much higher fixed costs and very low running costs, like for solar or for wind. So what we have now, the opportunity is really to invest into this, be it the renewable energy production, be it the transmission systems, but be it also the energy efficiency, the renovation of our buildings, which has a huge potential to save energy for the future and also increase the quality of our lives. So what the higher prices in the emission trading system can now, of course, offer is the right price signal to even increase the push to renewables. And it's for us at the European Commission, it's for the national governments to use these revenues, right? Because these revenues not only go to us in Brussels, but the largest share goes to the governments of the member states, who know best how to invest those money. But that this is really used to speed up this energy transition, so that we can even sooner then benefit from this new energy system with quite low energy costs and of course a very high energy security, because all with this change to the renewables, we of course reduce very significantly our reliance on energy imports.
So for you, this is just positive. You'd like to see it go up further.
What we need to do is to get on a good good path. Huh? It's not about killing industry. Huh? It's about the planning certainty where we want to go towards 2050, and what we want is a credible and reliable price signal. It doesn't make any sense if we have like a very fluctuating carbon price, because this again only increases the uncertainty. So this is also why we designed our emission trading system such with the market stability reserve and so on, that we will always have enough liquidity on the market. But of course, the price developments as they are now, I think they are pointing into the right direction. But I think it's not only about the price that you see now, but it's also about the expectation, because a lot of these investments are driven by the expectations of the carbon price in 2030, 40, 2050. So it's really about, from us, for a policymaker, it's really about giving enough certainty and a clear perspective. And I think what we've now in a very long time done with the climate law, with saying that Europe should be climate neutral by 2050. And then what we will do with our proposals now before summer on the Fit for 55 package, where we will look into the 2030 targets of 55% and make the proposals on the emission trading system, on the national targets, on the renewables directive, and so on.
Yes. Martin, what's the carbon price doing for you at the moment? Thank you.
Well, I like to echo what Christian says. So for me, I can only be positive. Like I said before, the Nordics is particularly leading in terms of adding taxes on top of the CO2. I think it's very important on this pathway to 2030, 2050, we are inclusive and we bring along the industry as well. I think the Nordics tax a lot, but they also provide then the means and the financial support for industry to make that transition. And that is also true, I think, at the European scale. ETS prices at 50, arguably, they're not at the levels that the Nordics or the Netherlands or Denmark have taxations on top of it. There is a need to go maybe even beyond that, but we can only do that if we are inclusive and keep the industrial activity in Norway as in Europe as well, and make sure we are doing an inclusive transition. So yeah, I think that is really important, to be honest. So
absolutely. And Timo, just on a more direct basis, what impact does the high carbon price have on the Estonian NECP?
The first impact is that we will meet our 2030 carbon reduction targets more quicker. So of course we can all sort of say that this is an excellent news that we have overachieved our already ambitious -70% target. But of course every story has, you know, also two sides or two perspectives. So the other perspective is that of course every or all big transformations in energy take time, and if the carbon prices are sort of, well, unpredictable, let's call it that way, because no one would have predicted it a year ago that today we are, you know, in an environment with 50 euros per ton CO2 price, then there is highly risk that sort of the energy system on one hand is really sort of quick to decarbonize itself by simply shutting down and units, but the big question is that what is the energy which is going to substitute or take the place of the fossil energy which is forced out of the market. And over here I am a bit cautious that right now the substitution comes from third countries, from the countries where maybe the carbon is not priced at all or taxed at all, and this is really a worrisome trend. And over here I really hope to see on 14th of July, when Fit for 55 package is coming out, a measures which are addressing that. I'm referring to the carbon border adjustment mechanism and also in the electricity sector. So this is really important. Otherwise, you know, we are just artificially sort of reaching our targets more sooner, more quicker, but on a global scale we are just creating a hefty business cases for countries who are, you know, dragging their feet maybe. So this is definitely one downside of carbon price going up that quickly. So that the industry needs some time to adjust. Industry needs for that predictability, which, well, is, I guess, missing right now, because European Commission own prediction for the carbon price, if I recall correctly, predicted that we will see the price range which we are right now around 50 by 2030. So I think we really have to see how to make the system more predictable, this is needed for the energy industry to adjust ourselves. Otherwise we are just, you know, handing over our sort of energy market to maybe a market participants who are a bit more reluctant taxing their industries.
It's a very interesting point, yes, and one I'm actually quite happy to finish this on, because that leads on to whatever else is coming. So thank you very much, gentlemen. It has been an absolute pleasure having you on this panel. And back to you, Laura.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, everybody. Great discussions. Now we will have a presentation by Ms. Beatrice Coda, head of unit at CINEA at the EU Commission. And she will speak about the role of action supported by the Connecting Europe facility in achieving a modern, secure and smart energy infrastructure in the region.